Today I will talk on blood transfusion safety during COVID-19. Since 1975, WHO has been at the forefront of the movement to improve global blood safety. The objective of WHO blood transfusion safety program is to ensure provision of universal access to safe, quality, and effective blood and blood products and their appropriate use, and also to ensure blood donor and patient safety. Blood safety aims to ensure that everyone has access to safe blood available at reasonable cost, adequate to meet the needs of patients, transfused only when it's necessary, and provided as part of sustainable blood program system. Developing countries face a chronic shortage of blood, which particularly affects children with severe anemia and malnutrition. As developing countries expand diagnostic and treatment options, the demand for blood is rising. Technological advances in developed countries have led to new medical treatment regimes and procedures requiring transfusion. The key of safe blood transfusion is voluntary unpaid blood donors. People who give blood of their own free will without receiving any form of cash or any kind of payment, they are the most safe donors to be getting blood transfusion from them. Evidence from around the world shows that the prevalence of infection in general is the lowest among voluntary unpaid donors. WHO reported in 2018 that of the 119 million blood donations approximately collected globally, 40% of these are collected in high-income countries, which is the home to 16% of world population. Based on samples of 1,000 people, the blood donation rate is around 32 donations in high-income countries and around 16 donations in upper-middle-income countries, 7 donations in lower-middle-income countries, and 5 donations in lower-income countries in 1,000 people. Blood safety nationally can be through having or establishment of well-organized, nationally coordinated blood transfusion service, a collection of blood from the volunteer unpaid donors, quality assured testing for transfusion transmitted infection, the safe and appropriate blood use, quality system covering the entire transfusion process from donor recruitment up to following up of recipients after transfusion. Usually, hospitals require to have adequate stock of safe blood products, adequate number of qualified and trained staff, system for patient identifications, a hemovigilance system to be in place, clinical transfusion process, and functioning hospital transfusion committee, transfusion safety officer, if possible, donor and patient information and consent, suitable hospital blood bank infrastructure. Now, this part is the main subject of my presentation today, which is the challenges for blood centers during the COVID-19 outbreak. What are the challenges? Challenges for blood transfusion during COVID-19 is a challenge to our blood donors and our personal working in donation area and blood centers, and also our recipients of blood transfusion. Many countries experience reduced donation. Donors fear infection because of frequent traffic in blood centers. Personnel could be infected by asymptomatic SARS-CoV-2 positive donors that could affect the blood centers, and due to crowded area of people who are coming to donate, and if any staff contracted the infection even from outside environment. Transfusion recipients could be potentially infected by SARS-CoV-2, but this is, till now, is theoretical, and we'll talk about it later. What are the donor concerns? Donor always ask, will I get COVID-19 at blood centers? Is it safe to donate blood? And the measures taken to just taken by blood centers to mitigate risk is fixed appointment to keep distance between donors, masks of donor entering, hand disinfection or hand washing, distance between waiting chairs and donation sites. Donors are advised to book appointments usually and to keep distance. They need to wear the mask all the time. We usually take temperature before entering for the donors and staff. They have to wash hands and they have to report any symptoms after donation to the donor centers. For the staff personnel, again, they have to wear masks, gloves, disinfecting, protective clothing. Donors must wear masks also, and they have to disinfect their hands, as we said before. And we usually take the temperature for all staffs before they entering to work every morning. And they have to check their symptoms before reporting duty. And they have to wear masks all the time, wear gloves for bin puncture, and wash their hands and frequent use of alcohol hand drops. The donation process, standard blood precaution procedure to be followed, covering all blood transfusion chain. And they have, again, to change of bed sheets and disinfecting the donor chairs after every donation. And they have to keep distance in the donation area. The challenging also for patients or for transfusion recipients, usually there is no available testing for blood donors for COVID or COVID-19 or for the SARS-CoV-2. And there is no routine testing till now in the centers. But bacterial inactivation of platelets and plasma is there in certain countries, and it's not available in all countries around the world, but it is a good step for making more the products more safe to give to the recipient. How we can improve blood use and how we can improve blood usage and unnecessary use of blood and guard against shortage of blood nowadays, we should consider patient blood management. Patient blood management is an evidence-based approach to optimize the care of patients who may need blood transfusion. Through improving the patient's own blood and avoid unnecessary transfusion, the use of alternative measures to blood transfusion, adhere to strict transfusion guidelines, evidence-based transfusion threshold or triggers, and why give to when one will do. This is choosing wisely campaign, which is done or carried on in US by ABB for red cell blood transfusion, that they return back to use one unit instead of two units in certain patients and in patients who doesn't need to get two units at the same time. Reduction of non-emergency surface, elective procedure, and preoperative anemia management. For elective surgery, preoperative anemia management program should be in all hospitals, that instead of getting patients to have their operation while they are anemic, it's better to have anemia clinic and just to treat anemia before giving them appointment for elective surgery. Reduce phlebotomy blood loss, and this is important also measure to be taken. For chronic transfusion patients, they are affected by COVID-19 pandemic. Through they may catch the infection itself, or through we couldn't give them the blood whom they needed, and not always available because of shortage of blood, and they are facing under transfusion, and this is a problem for a lot of thalassemic patients nowadays. And we have to guard against it. Inventory supply shortage often contribute to the delay in transfusing these patients in daycare setting. It is recommended that hospital maintain an adequate inventory at all times. The other thing I have to discuss or just give some information about is the transmission risk of SARS-CoV-2. Is there any risk? We need to know first the antibody development after any patient gets the infection. Usually at the start, we can detect through DNA, RNA, PCR, we can detect the infection itself, the viral presence in the blood. And for the first week, it started to increase, and by 4 to 6 weeks, it's becoming negative, usually, but it can be still positive up to 1 month, 2 months. It can happen in few patients. In general, it's decreased by week 4 or 5, and IgM antibodies starting from first week and increasing, then it's decreasing again by week 5 or 6. IgG antibodies starting also with IgM, and it can continue for longer period, and this can give more protection to the donors. And usually when we choose donor for convalescence plasma, we are measuring neutralizing antibody or the IgG antibodies to make sure that they have good titer that we can use their plasma. Low genomic viral load in plasma is detected in symptomatic patients, mild or severe, or even in asymptomatic patients. Evidence for viremia in asymptomatic donors that have been found in many researches, and this makes risk for blood donation, but it's still theoretical risk. No proof till today that it can be transmitted. Rate of asymptomatic infection unknown yet. Transfusion transmission not showing yet, considered, as I said, theoretical risk. And this paper was published by Chang from China. What will be next? We have to think about it. We have up to today around more than 1,000 viruses worldwide, and a lot of viruses become having outbreak and become endemic or pandemic, and making a lot of trouble through this year's since 1918 with Spanish flu outbreak. There are many viruses having outbreaks and making problem, and they have to face what to do. And some of them we can have vaccines for it, some of them no. One of them is coronaviruses in general. SARS-CoV virus 1 and MERS-CoV virus, and now it's a SARS-CoV virus 2. And all this can occur, and it's still MERS-CoV virus still occurring, and still we have cases in Saudi Arabia for MERS-CoV virus 2 till today. And for SARS-CoV 2, it is a pandemic, and it is more than other viruses affecting the whole world. There is no specific treatment till now. Vaccines is about to be developed. There is a good news about vaccines coming soon, and we hope that it will be effective. But we have to think, what will be next? When will be the next? How and how fast it will be transmitted? How and how fast disease will progress? In this way, we have to be, we should be prepared. The way forward is we have to take into consideration safe blood comes from safe donors. To have a safe donor, we need to have a great support from facilities available, mobile units, media coverage, and through proper diagnostic equipment, educational materials, use for donation, for blood donation, and for education of community, testing materials and consumables. Total management for adequate safe blood supply. In summary, blood safety extremely variable globally. Major determinants of risk are, one of them important is the infection prevalence and incidence. Solution must be tailored to environment locally. Creative approaches are always needed. In conclusion, establishment of appropriate and adequate inventory level to react and respond to internal and external disaster, it's a must. Ensure appropriate use of all products. This means thinking of having patient blood management program and try to establish in our hospitals. Provide timely available of products to meet the needs of chronically transfused dependent patients. Measure to restore and gain public and donor confidence in blood donation are extremely important during any pandemic. Early implementation of measures enable us to secure blood safety and supply. We have to learn from this pandemic to be ready with a clear, effective plan to secure blood safety and availability during this pandemic and any future pandemic. I would like to end this presentation by showing this leaflet or this brochure, which is done by Society of Transfusion Medicine and Society for Thalassemia on COVID and blood donation. Was showing the instruction which we are giving to public that to understand how they can donate, when they can donate blood. Thank you. I just have to stop.